So this is my book, Airship Roma, Disaster in Hampton Roads. Basically, I stumbled across Roma 5 years ago. I was looking through the wonderful online collection we have here through the Norfolk Public Library at Sargent Memorial. And I found this picture of Roma, and I was completely engrossed in her story. And ever since then, it has been my mission to tell her story. So I'm going to transport you back to 1921. This was a time of innovation. It was a time of hope. It was a time of spirit. It was just a wonderful, happy time. We had just survived World War I, the scourge of the Spanish flu, and we were looking towards the future for new innovations, new prosperity, new everything. And so this is a wonderful postcard from around that time period, Granby Street. So to talk about World War I and airships. Throughout World War I, Germany proved the validity of airships. They could move faster, go higher, they carry more cargo, more people, than their lighter than air counterparts. To give you, or their heavier than air counterparts, excuse me. To give you an idea of how fragile the airplanes were at that time, during our short stay in World War I, about a little over a year, we only had 2,200 out of 10,000 serviceable planes. So it was obvious why the military returned to airships as a more practical means of air transportation. It was such an innovation that at one point, there was a Navy admiral who said that these were going to take the place of aircraft carriers someday. You can believe that. Not to be outdone by the Navy, who was charged with the rigid, large ships like what we think of Hindenburg, Brigadier General Billy Mitchell started lobbying the War Department to get a big airship of their own. It was going to be used on the surface publicly for like transportation and training, but really they wanted to experiment with reconnaissance technology. So the War Department finally said, okay, Navy has passed on this smaller, big airship from Italy. Why don't you guys go ahead and get it? To which we come with Roma. So they picked the best and the brightest that the Army Air Service had to offer. So to introduce you to these eight gentlemen, this is Lieutenant Walter J. Reed, not the same as the general that we all think of. This is Major John G. Thornell with the most unfortunate mustache. This is Captain Dale Mabry. He was the second in command of Roma, and he was a bit of a playboy from Tampa. This right here is Master Sergeant Roger McNally. He was from Alaska. When he heard, he was working for the Department of the Interior, when he heard we entered World War I, he walked straight to Seward to enlist. So he was a little older than the other guys, but he was definitely a trustworthy man. He was going to be the leading enlisted man on the ship. This is Master Sergeant Harry Chapman. This is Sergeant Marion Jethro Bell from La Plata, Missouri. This is Sergeant Virgil Hoffman. And this is Sergeant Joseph Biedenbach, who was the only one of these men who did not serve during World War I, but he was definitely proved himself very quickly in the air service. The commanding officer, Major John Gray Thornell, he finished near the bottom of his class at West Point. And then he entered into the war, into the infantry. But then he found his niche in the lighter-than-air community, and he really excelled, and he made a name for himself. So he was chosen as the obvious person to take command of the new airship. Walter J. Reed, who I just introduced you to, who is this gentleman right here, he had served during World War I, gotten out, and they called him back into service for Roma. So he called up his girlfriend, Maria Blackiston of Hampton, and said, hey, do you want to get married? They're telling me to go to Italy. She's like, huh, that would be a great honeymoon. So they got married. And this is their wedding photo, the day before they left for Italy. And right here is Captain Mabry, who was best friends with Lieutenant Reed, and he served as the best man. And the next day, they sailed to Italy. Sergeant Virgil Hoffman, who I introduced you to earlier, he was a native of Eaton Rapids, Michigan. He he was in the service, he got out, but when he was in, he was at Langley Field and met this nice young lady, Stella Hoover, of Phoebus. So they called him back in. He said, you know what, I'll only go back in if you let me go to Langley to be with Stella. Needless to say, he was back at Langley. So Roma was an interesting airship. She was what was called a semi-rigid dirigible. Now, how is this different from a Zeppelin? Zeppelins are what we think of, like I said earlier, like the Hindenburg. This bag right here, which we call the gas bag, is held together by a skeletal structure, while a blimp doesn't, and it's much smaller. This semi-rigid has a rigid structure, so this part right here is a skeletal structure, but inside here are 11 mini balloons that hold the shape. So it was a really innovative piece of technology. But the truth was, she was a secondhand airship. She was built in 1919, originally for World War I, but when World War I came to an end before the end of her construction, they had to refit her. They originally intended for the Crown of Italy to fly her between Rome and Buenos Aires, or Rio de Janeiro, excuse me, for transport, but that never came to be. They just used her for sightseeing missions. So needless to say, they were ready, for reasons we can only guess, to get rid of her. Now, the Americans that were sent over were allowed only one inspection flight of the ship. And this was the day of the inspection flight in March of 1921. This gentleman right here is Umberto Nobile. He was one of the engineers of the ship, one of the designers. And the day of the flight, it was a party. We had Robert Underwood Johnson, who was the American ambassador to Italy. We had Prince Viggo of Denmark. We had the elite rubbing elbows. Maria Reed was able to go up with her new husband on the ship. It was a party. So Kenneth Roberts, who was a columnist at the time, and he went on to be known as a novelist later on, was on board, and he described it as having a Prisoner of Zenda feel. Wine was flowing freely. Keep in mind, this is during Prohibition. They had three-course meals, and often the wheel was left unattended, and anyone who wanted to fly it could. It was a party, no inspection. They were having so much fun, they didn't even notice when the flight plan kind of changed, when they were originally supposed to fly over the caldera of Vesuvius, and went over to the side. And the theory was because the ship was leaking the gas, hydrogen, and couldn't get over the caldera. But nobody noticed. So after this day-long party, Major Thornell stumbles off, and he telegrams his superiors saying, "I am most impressed with the semi-rigid type of airship and believe it has great possibilities." This is a picture of one of the original contracts. Italy originally asked for $475,000, but they readily negotiated down to $184,000. Thornell asked to fly the ship back to Langley Field here in Virginia, and the War Department's like, no, just pack her up. Knowing that the ship was a few years old, they also asked for a new gas bag, and the War Department's like, no, this one will be fine. The thing is about this gas bag, it was made out of a silk and cotton blend and could only be made in Italy and required a 6-month lead time. So that's something to keep in mind coming up. In the meantime, we had several lighter-than-air accidents, and we really started understanding the dangers of hydrogen. Most notably in 1921 would be the R-38, which was a British airship that was being built for the United States. During a test flight before the United States accepted it, that included both naval aviators from the United States and from Great Britain, the structural integrity gave way. The oxygen mixed with hydrogen and the ship exploded. Only 5 out of 49 men survived this flight. So Roma arrived here in crates in August 1921. We all know what August is like around here, muggy and terrible. They unpacked the crates, and all over this gas bag that we were previously talking about was mildew, holes. One of the men described it as resembling lukewarm beeswax. The hangar log reads like a sewing pattern of patches that they had to constantly keep putting onto this gas bag. In the meantime, we have more crew members joining the ship. We have Lieutenant Byron T. Burt Jr., and it's kind of debatable whether or not he was a lucky man to have on board. He had survived 3 lighter-than-air accidents. But he was a great engineer. He really understood how these ships worked. And here we have him standing next to Captain Mabry. We have some other gentlemen that joined the ship. In particular, I'm going to point out to you Corporal Alberto Duke Flores. And he was a trusted man. He was put at a very precarious position, which I'll point out to you in a moment, in the crow's nest of the ship. So he was on the front of the ship, not attached to anything, when it was up in the air, and it was his job to make sure that that bag stayed tight. Signs were posted on the hangar, basically warning everyone, don't light any matches around here, no flames. The soles of people's shoes were checked for tacks and nails to make sure there wouldn't be any sparks because of the volatile hydrogen that was used. Like I said, they had difficulty maintaining hydrogen purity. The less pure the hydrogen, the more volatile it was, the more likely it would be to explode. But finally, they had enough patches and they were able to maintain her integrity. And so a trial flight was scheduled for November 15th, 1921. It was highly publicized and everyone was excited to go see this wonderful Grand Eagle fly for the first time. This is November 15th, 1921. There were a great deal of people there. There are reports estimating about 1,000 people there. There were loved ones of family members of the crew. There were reporters. Everyone came from all around. This was the exciting thing to see this gigantic ship fly for the first time, almost 500 feet long and almost 100 feet tall. This was the rudder on the back of the ship, which was innovative for the time, and it's important to just kind of remember what this looked like. This was the piece of the ship that the crew least trusted. They least trusted this because it was so new that they had movable vertical and horizontal surfaces. So as they were rising, which they had perfect lift, as you can see, everyone was holding their breath. And once they reached the air, Major Thornell radioed down, "How did we look?" To which from the ground they radioed back, "Magnificent." Everyone was excited. When they would fly over Hampton, Lieutenant Reed dropped a messenger bag out the window onto the property of his in-laws, let his bride know that he was okay, everything was going fine. And when they flew over Phoebus, Virgil Hoffman would lean out the window and scream down to his fiancée, who would be waiting just to look up at him. However, there were issues on this flight. The engines were made for southern Italian climates, and so they ran oily, and November here is unpredictable, and it kept freezing. The engineer, Marion Jethro Bell, kept noting that he had a great deal of strain just keeping his engine going. He had to keep pouring boiling water on top of it. At about 11 a.m., an aluminum door broke off of the hull and slammed into one of the propeller blades. The propeller blade shattered and tore holes in the bag. Knowing that they had moments just to save the ship, Sergeant Lee Harris jumped into action. He knew he had to save his crewmates. He grabbed 2 other men and went up into the bag, and he patched it as much as he could until he passed out from inhaling the hydrogen. But they saved the ship. And at the end, the men were safe as well. Overall, the flight was hailed a success. Not necessarily for the crew, though. They started speaking amongst each other how they were just very hesitant to go on this ship. They formed what was called the Graveyards Club, led by Jethro Bell. He started petitioning to get off the ship. He knew that if it was going down one day, everyone was going to die. He kept writing to his family about it, but he was one of the best engineers they had. They weren't going to let him off the ship. In the meantime, Clifford Tinker, who we met earlier with the R-38, started petitioning the War Department, yelling to whoever would listen to use helium. So they decided just to satiate him that they would give it a try. The Navy flew their small airship, the C-7, on three flights between Norfolk and DC. They noticed some interesting things. Helium didn't expand or contract like hydrogen did, and they didn't lose any gas. So this was a long-term fiscal advantage, even though helium was initially a more expensive gas to use. Aerial Age Weekly, which was a popular journal at the time, even said, summed up, it can be said that the use of helium as a gas for inhalation of airships has been demonstrated beyond a doubt. Quietly, the helium plant at Fort Worth, Texas was closed. Tinker went to Major Percy E. Van Nostrand, who was the director of lighter-than-air development for the Army Air Service, and showed how it would cost $14,000 to transport the helium needed from Fort Worth to Langley for Roma. And Van Nostrand told him, we don't have any money, we can't do it, we're gonna have to keep using hydrogen. December 21st, 1921 was the day of the christening ceremony for Roma. They flew the ship up to Bowling Field in DC, and they had significant troubles with the engines as they did the previous flight. They limped into Bowling Field several hours late on only three of six working engines. As you can see, they are having a great deal of trouble even getting her down to the ground. And there's an interesting thing I want to see if anyone notices with the flag, which is kind of hard to tell here. So people were on the ground, they were waiting, and they were very scared what was going to happen. They decided to cut the ceremony short. Everyone was freezing. And then during the ceremony, after they managed to finally pull the ship to the ground, the ship rolled to the side, damaging another engine. And this is when they're dropping the ropes down to try to pull her down. And this normally wouldn't have been such a hard process, but needless to say, they were happy to be on the ground. That evening, they were sent back with a skeleton crew. Most of the men were sent back on a train. And the flag is upside down. And now that was an ironic accident that the flag was upside down. It's a sign of distress. But when they came into Langley that evening, only one of the six engines was working. So attention diverted from the issues they were having with the gas bag to the engines. And they decided to change them out with the more well-known Liberty V-12 engines. And until they put the new engines on the ship was grounded. At this time, Thornell was up for orders, and he accepted orders up in DC, but they said, you can fly on her one more time as an observer. Captain Mabry was promoted to commanding officer, and Lieutenant Reed was promoted to captain and also the executive officer of the ship. They decided at that time it was okay, they could order a new bag, but she would have to fly in the meantime. Civilians arrived from Dayton, Ohio to help fit the new engines onto the ship, and Walter McNair from the Bureau of Standards up in Washington, D.C., he was a physicist, came to test certain tools to see how fast the ship would run. At this point, she had never flown any faster than 54 miles per hour. A test for the new engines was scheduled on February 21st, 1922, nearly 95 years ago. The night before, February 20th, a party was held at the Officers Club at Langley. It was a dance, they were having fun, they were celebrating that the next day they would fly this grand eagle, American Eagle, as the newspapers were hailing it. Student observers from the field were going to be on board that day, including Majors Walter Waltzmeyer and Major John Reardon. Stella Hoover attended with Virgil Hoffman. They were dancing the night away and planning their June wedding. Walter Reed was not in attendance, though, because he was suffering from the flu. The next day was a cold and dreary day. They weren't sure whether or not they were going to fly that day. Reed stumbled into the hangar against his wife's better wishes. Being a military wife myself, I understand if the ship's going, so is he. They were uncertain they were going to fly that day, so Mabry said to all the men, go grab something to eat, I'll let you know what's happening. Corporal Irby Hevron, who was a flying member of the crew, turned to his friend, Corporal Nathan Curru, who was not part of the crew, and said, kind of jokingly, if anything happens to me, you take me home. At the last minute, Mabry said, okay, we're going to fly today. And he rushed everyone back to the hangar. They were in such a rush, they left the ship's mascot dog behind. The ground's crew noticed something as they were pulling it out. A silver triangular patch flew off the top of the ship. At the beginning of the flight, there were noticeable problems. Instead of going up like we saw before, she was going up nose heavy. Mabry was ordering everyone to move as far aft as possible. They had to gain horizontal equilibrium. And eventually they did. But Master Sergeant Chapman noticed he had a lot of trouble maintaining purity in the front and the back of the gas bag. Walter McNair noticed the ship was moving exceptionally fast. His tool clocked out at 75 miles per hour, but he guessed it was moving faster than that. These Liberty engines were lighter than the previous engines. Captain Reed and Lieutenant Burt also noticed the ship was more sensitive than usual. But Thornell said, these Liberties are the stuff. Over Old Point Comfort, Reed just became overcome with the symptoms of the flu and retired to the passenger cabin. Corporal Flores, who was located about right here at the top of the ship, went to go measure the back, and he noticed it was loose. He climbed down to get down to warn everyone, but he noticed he couldn't pass the passageway. It was collapsing. In the meantime, in the control cabin, Lieutenant Burt started pulling on the ropes and the controls, and they just moved loosely in his hands. He turned to Captain Mabry. Captain, she won't respond. Mabry ordered everyone to throw everything off. They had to lighten the load. He wanted to get it over to the Norfolk Country Club. He ordered the engines to shut off. The aft and the center engines were shut off, but for reasons we still don't know today, the forward engines were not. They were moving to the ground too quickly. The quartermaster depot, now Norfolk International Terminal, everyone was rushing out. They knew they had to aid them. They knew, the men on the ship knew that if this was to save themselves, it was no longer to save the ship. The passenger cabin, everyone was huddled together, praying, crying, panicked. Lieutenant Riley, a student observer, lurched toward the opening of the door. Before anyone could stop him, he jumped. The last words anyone heard before they crashed was Captain Mabry screaming, "My God, boys." As they were approaching the ground, Lieutenant Flores lurched at his opening on the top of the ship. He knew he had mere moments to save himself. The moment the tip of the ship touched the ground, he jumped, and he ran and ran, and he didn't stop until someone caught him, and then a tremendous explosion behind him. The rudder of the ship grazed a telephone wire and ignited the hydrogen inside the ship. Anyone who hadn't gone out before that explosion wouldn't. Eyewitnesses recalled hearing voices and seeing vestiges in the flames, screaming, "Mercy, oh mercy," before they disappeared into the flames. On a roadway nearby lay the body of Lieutenant Riley. The ship wasn't high enough for his parachute to fully open. The survivors were rushed to a nearby hospital. Maria Reed heard about what happened very quickly and insisted someone fly her over to find her husband. She had to know where he was. Thankfully, she found him at the public health hospital. The survivors were unsure who had escaped the flames. When a reporter clandestinely came in and they asked him, "What about the other boys?" And he had the unfortunate duty of telling them that they were the only ones who had survived. Only 11 men out of 45 survived. Only 11. At the scene, it was obvious to those on the ground that it was more of a recovery than a rescue effort. They began pulling the bodies from the crash, pinning onto them trinkets, coins, insignia, whatever they could to help identify these men. The last man to be pulled out, who is pictured here, was still clutching a control wheel. Lieutenant Burt, who was in the control cabin and managed to escape relatively unscathed, so this is his fourth escape, returned to the scene. And to me, this is the most haunting of the images. He couldn't believe that just these were his brothers that he had flown with. These were the men he served during the war with. In mere moments, they were gone. The victims were taken to Rouse Funeral Home over in Newport News. Dr. Jesse Mabry, who was the older brother of Captain Mabry, came to help with the identification process however he could. He had to find his little brother. Stella Hoover waited for Virgil at Langley Field. Well into the night, the dead were identified. They included Major Thornell, Sergeant Virgil Hoffman, and Sergeant Jethro Bell. The last man to be identified, the man holding the control wheel, was Captain Dale Mabry. A hero to the end, he never left his post. Captain William Kepner, who was a non-flying member of the crew, was on hand to help identify his brother's remains. He had the unfortunate duty of helping the grieving families as they arrived. One father asked him, "Are you sure it's my son? He has a scar on his pelvis. Did you see it?" Captain Kepner said, "I assure you, sir, it is your son." The bereaved father said, "Are you sure? Did you see the scar?" And he had the unfortunate duty, Kepner did, of informing this father that his son's pelvis was missing. An inquiry was held under strict secrecy, and the survivors were told they were not allowed to speak to the press or anyone. They posed for photos and they smiled as best they could, but they had the injuries and the mental anguish of what they went through. Here we see Corporal Flores and Sergeant Biedenbach. So the question was, what caused the death of these men? It was obvious with Lieutenant Riley that he died on impact. The other men, their death certificates are listed as having died in the fire. But what caused the fire? During the inquiry, Lieutenant Clarence Welch was asked, if there had been a non-burning gas, like helium used, would more people have survived? To which he responded, "I am sure the ship would not have burned so quickly, but what a great number of men could have been saved in an attempt made to have saved the others." On February 24th, an elaborate ceremony was held in Newport News to honor the dead. Two bodies were chosen to represent the crew, Captain Mabry and Private John E. Thompson, because his was the only one that went unclaimed. Hundreds gathered in the streets, crying, screaming, clutching them together as if this was their own loved one. The Huntington Rifles came and they played along with the funeral procession. The ship's mascot dog was on hand, which you see down here, as they sang hymns and they read soliloquies over the dead. The Secretary of State for Virginia promised a grand monument would go up to honor these men. They would never be forgotten. In the months following the disaster, debate raged. Should we end the lighter-than-air program altogether? Or should we continue using hydrogen? The short answer is they chose to use helium and continue lighter than air. In the years to follow, we had several other airship disasters involving helium, and an inquiry was held. During this inquiry, it came to light that in 1922, the War Department returned a surplus to the Treasury of $6.5 million. $1.3 million was supposed to be used for transportation of supplies for the Army Air Service, including helium. As Lieutenant Clifford Tinker pointed out, it would have cost them $14,000 to transport helium for that one flight, money they readily had available. But they chose to negligently not spend that money despite knowing the dangers of hydrogen. This cost them approximately $412 per life lost that day, money they readily had. The story was buried with the victims and long forgotten. As for the survivors, they carried the literal and emotional scars for the rest of their life. Master Sergeant Harry Chapman, who was probably the most badly injured of the men, spent a year recovering from his injuries, and he was the only man given any sort of commendation for heroism that day. He died in 1940 from lung cancer that they assumed came from the damage from his lungs from that day in 1922, the last victim of Roma. Another civilian suffered from what would be called today post-traumatic stress disorder. The last surviving member of the crew, Corporal Alberto Flores, retired as a master sergeant. He would tell everyone about the stories of his time on the airships, but he would never again fly after Roma. He passed away in 1988 in Belleville, Illinois, and I have the honor of having his funerary flag out in the lobby, courtesy of his loved one, Judy Loudon. There is no grand memorial for Roma, but after the terminals moved into where the Quartermaster Depot is now, the men that worked there pulled their money together and they put together this stone to honor the crash. It is now behind a locked gate on private property, completely inaccessible to the public. This is a picture I took of it in 2014, and it's not in the best condition. Over the past 5 years now, I have had the great honor of meeting family members and loved ones and other historians connected to Roma. Over this process, recently we have pursued having a Virginia Historical Highway marker placed, and we are working with the city of Norfolk and the state of Virginia to honor them. So they will at last have a public tribute for their sacrifice that day. These are the names and some of the pictures of victims. As for Stella Hoover, the fiance of Virgil Hoffman, she went on and got married, but as her children have expressed to me, that was a loss she never really got over. She went on to have 10 children, so she had a happy marriage. It has been my absolute privilege to tell their story, to bring their lives into my own, and to bring them back to life. And I want to thank you for having me here tonight and for sharing their story with you. Thank you.